The Earth is full of interesting geographical features. You know, the kinds you've all seen on those posters that show you what they're all called. Things like coves and estuaries and plateaus and peninsulas and canyons and all that stuff. But what about on other planets and moons? They're just as geographically varied as the Earth, but scientists who study them generally use different names for them. So how many of you know what a planitia is? Or a chasma? Or a valles? Hello everyone, this is your weekly dose of geography. Now, as familiar or unfamiliar as many may be about the different geographical terms used here on Earth, replace your forests and rivers and lakes with craters and chasmata and planitiae, and we begin to see some very different names indeed used within these spheres. Now, maybe this isn't necessarily geography, since geo literally refers to the Earth. Think the whole geocentric versus heliocentric debate. So, is there perhaps a more appropriate term? Well, in all honesty, geography might actually be fine. But what if we replace geo with astro? That gives us astrography, not to be confused with astronomy or astrology, which doesn't actually help us at all since that actually refers to star charts and things like that, i.e. how the stars are positioned, not the features of the things orbiting said stars. What about another term? Planetology. More commonly known as planetary science, planetology, as we'll call it for simplicity and because it sounds cool, is a very wide study encompassing studies of planets, moons, and planetary systems, with one field being astrogeology. Alright, let's get down to the individual terms. First, just what the hell is a planitia? In short, planitia derives from the word plane. And indeed a planitia, like Mars's Utopia planitia where the USS Enterprise D was built, is a low-lying plane, also similar to a planum. Yeah, not exactly much more to that, it's just a plane. A chasma is also somewhat similar to a certain word it sounds like. Think chasm, except a chasma refers to a steep-sided depression, with one notable example being the Ithaca chasma on Saturn's moon Tethys. Shallow out the depressions though, and you get a fossa, a long, narrow, shallow-sided depression. And in this case, not a small carnivorous mammal indigenous to Madagascar known for eating lemurs. Oh, by the way, yes, the fossa are indeed real. Lastly, in our list of plains and valleys is a valles, which, as I'm sure you can guess by its name and its association with Mars's Valles Marineris, the largest valley in the solar system, a valles is just that, a kind of valley. Now, there's one very key and obvious difference between the Earth and the other planets and moons of the solar system. The Earth is where we live, and everywhere else we look at through telescopes. What this means is that, although we can't exactly measure the population density on Ganymede, how much light is reflected off a particular surface is indeed quite important in naming astrogeological regions, a measurement referred to as albedo. Something that would obviously never apply to Earth geography. So first in this category is an albedo feature, an indeed very broad measurement that can refer to just about anything as long as it looks exceptionally bright to a telescope, in contrast to surrounding areas. In this sense, a macula is kind of the opposite, being an unusually dark region of a body, and a regio is an area differentiated by color or albedo. Think Pluto's Tomba regio. Last among this crowd is a terra. Not to be confused with the name for Earth in pretty much all of science fiction, a terra is a rough upland or a mountainous region, with a high albedo. So, a crater is what's left behind when a body of any kind collides with another body of any kind. Now, basically everyone knows that. Hell, we even have a few on Earth. But when that happens multiple times in a long line, that results in a feature known as a catena. Best seen here with the Encke Catena on Ganymede. A patera, however, is a crater that's either irregular in shape or with scalloped edges, and can also be formed by volcanoes instead of asteroids, though that's not a requirement for that. Speaking of well-known features on the moon, you know how the Apollo 11 mission landed in the Sea of Tranquility? Well, you do now, but since the moon can't support liquid water on its surface, its seas are correctly known as maria, singular mare, which can mean different things on different bodies, like a large dark flatlands on the moon, a dark albedo area on Mars, or on Titan, an actual sea. Just made of liquid methane, because Titan. Okay, that's enough talk about things dipping down into the surface. Let's now talk about things jutting up out of the surface. The tallest of which on Earth is, of course, Mount Everest. But within the solar system, it is Mars's Olympus Mons. A mons is just the word for a mountain, while a montes refers to a mountain range. A mensa on Earth refers to an organization of people with super high IQs, but on other worlds is a flat top prominence with cliff-like edges, i.e. a mesa. Going in rapid fire now, a tholus is a small dome-shaped mountain, like the Hecate's tholus on Mars. A dorsum refers to a ridge on a hill. An unde, when used on Venus, Mars, or Titan, refers to a field of dunes. And lastly for this list, a rupus is a kind of escarpment, which is itself kind of like the face of a cliff. Now, there are at least 40 other terms that I'm just completely tossing out the airlock for now, but to wrap this video up, I thought we'd also address just how these features are named. You can check out the Wikipedia page Planetary Nomenclature for the full list, including a hell of a lot of terms that we just skipped over. But regarding the names of these formations, you might have noticed a bit of a pattern with some of them, namely Greco-Roman mythology, among others. For instance, the features on Venus are mostly given feminine names. For example, Phossae are named after goddesses of war, Paterae are named after famous women, and Planitiae are named after mythological heroines. On the moon, however, craters are named after dead scientists, artists, and explorers, and many features, including Maria, are just named after Latin terms describing weather and abstract concepts, like tranquility. Finally, on the moons of Pluto, notably Charon, having only recently been mostly mapped, they just said, you know what, screw it. Kirk Crater, Vulcan Planum, Serenity Chasma, Ripley Crater, Kubrick Mons. So yeah, always nice to remember that NASA scientists are just like everyone else. Although, with that in mind, leave it up to the internet, we'd probably be seeing Swag Crater, or Heck and Chonker Mons, or Planitia McPlanitia Face. So that's that. Thanks for watching, and let me know what you thought about this. I have absolutely no idea how this video will do compared to my normal culture and politics related videos, so please let me know. Should I make more space videos? Like I really want to, but I'm too scared that the algorithm will punish me. Either way, like, share, and subscribe to learn something new every Sunday.